thank you so much and good evening. What a beautiful occasion. And seeing the families all come up who are so invested in the success of the museum is very, very powerful. I know a lot about this person. I've been married to her for nearly 33 years. But before I introduce my wife, I do want to say it's great to be back at Longwood, and it's great to be here in Farmville, and it's great to be back connected with friends, board members, supporters for the Moton Museum. I had a wonderful experience, Mr. President. You guys did a great job of bringing the world to Farmville in the vice presidential debate. And about 25 million people watched it. And I thought the most important thing I can say will be in my first paragraph when I talked about Barbara Johns. Because sadly, too few people in the country, even today, and thank you, Senator, for what you've done by making April 23rd Barbara Johns Day, too few people in the country today really know the story. And we should do everything we can to share and spread the story. And so a lot of people heard her name for the first time that night. And in an odd way, Barbara Johns is a little bit of a connector for me to my wife. I grew up in Kansas City. I had never been to Virginia except for a two-hour trip to Mount Vernon on a school trip when I was in high school. But when I was a student at the University of Missouri in 1978, a great book was published that I read when I was in college called Simple Justice by Richard Kluger. And it's probably the best book about American law that's ever been written, and Richard Kluger isn't a lawyer. But it's the story of the five cases that eventually became part of the Brown versus Board decision. And there's a chapter in that book called The Pride of Virginia. And it is the story of Barbara Johns and her classmates, and great local leaders like Reverend Griffin, and great civil rights lawyers like Spots Robinson and Oliver Hill, and the case that began with the walkout in April of 1951. And I read that book, and it reads like, you know, a John Grisham thriller. You just are compelled to tear your way through it because the story and the people are so fascinating. And when I finished reading that book, midway through my time in college, I was like, I want to be a civil rights lawyer. I didn't know any civil rights lawyers. I didn't even know any lawyers. But the characters were so captivating. And of any of the characters in this book, and there's stories about the case in South Carolina and Delaware and the District of Columbia and Kansas, Linda Brown and her family, of any of the characters in the book, maybe because she was a youngster, the Barbara Johns character stands out in a very luminous way. So I went to law school to be a civil rights lawyer. And when I was in law school, I met this very idealistic young Virginian, my wife, Anne. Anne had a particular story that she's going to tell you about it, because she, in her own way, with her family, played an important role in the integration of Virginia public education. And as I got to know her, I got to know a little bit about this story. And then we started a date, and then we got engaged, and then we came to Virginia, and we got married in November of 1984 and been married for 32 and a half years. My wife, Anne, had a pivotal, challenging, interesting, tough experience with her family when her dad was governor of Virginia within his first 6 months in office, when he was faced with the decision whether he would continue what had been the practice of Virginia governors, even 16 years after Brown versus Board, of doing anything they could to block kids from learning together if their skin colors were if they had different skin colors. And Anne and her family, with the kids very much participating in this, and she was 13 years old, 12 years old at the time, tried to play a leadership role from that particular perch that they occupied. And Anne became part of that generation of kids that integrated the Richmond public schools, and her father became the governor that said, we're going to close the chapter on the past and we're going to face forward and acknowledge that we should be an aristocracy of merit, not an aristocracy of race. From that experience, my wife then went on a number of years later to go to Princeton, to go to Harvard, to work as the Secretary of Education with great higher education institutions, Longwood and others. But I will say this, the school that had the most impact on her life and on who she is today at age 59, we both just turned 59, was Mosby Middle School, that middle school in Richmond, where she went to show that even the highest officials in government would comply with a court busing order. My wife Ann, after school, got to be a law clerk with the judge that had issued the busing order that everybody was subject to, Judge Bob Marriage in the District Court in Virginia. And then later, she worked when I was mayor, and we were able to open a school in our neighborhood that the Richmond School Board named after her dad in honor of his courage in trying to integrate schools and turn Virginia's direction from backward to forward. And then she got to be Secretary of Education, this kid who played a role at age 12 in an important move forward in Virginia's public schools under Governor McAuliffe, got to be Secretary of Education. My wife is a tireless and passionate advocate for kids. A juvenile court judge, a legal aid lawyer, a foster care reformer, a first lady who helped work with my team to fix the foster care system in Virginia, and then Secretary of Education. She stepped down and gave up a great job to join me on the campaign trail. And that was, you probably heard the joke about in the bacon and egg breakfast, the chicken makes a commitment and the pig makes a sacrifice. I made a commitment to be on a national ticket for 105 days, but I got to go back to my Senate job. I was the chicken, but my wife made a sacrifice, giving up her position as Secretary of Education to come out on the campaign trail. But now that we're in the next chapter in life, as a continuation of her commitment to school children in Virginia, Governor McAuliffe has asked her to serve on the State Board of Education, which oversees all of K-12 public education in the Commonwealth. She's the best public servant in my house. She is my great friend, my best friend, a wonderful mother of three, a wonderful daughter, sister, neighbor, friend, advocate for kids. Please give a warm welcome to my wife, Ann.
To be with you. What an honor to be introduced by my husband. We're usually in the opposite order. I prefer that. I prefer that. He's hard to follow. It is a special treat to be here. Thank you, Kanan, for inviting me. Kanan did a great job working with us in the Governor's Fellow's Office, and I'm so happy that Moten has you back here in this great role. What a treat to be with all of you and to watch all of those families we celebrated. Isn't this impressive that this degree of engagement in this community on behalf of this little history museum telling a little story? It's just really remarkable, and every single one of you deserves credit and honor, and I'm delighted to be here. Really, the main reason I'm delighted to be here is to help honor you. Just one word about my husband before we move on. We've been through quite a lot together in a lot of different chapters, but I'll tell you that, you know, folks ask me all the time, how's he doing? And I hope you can see by his enthusiasm today that he's doing just fine. Tim is at heart a civil rights lawyer, and he is back in the Senate fighting for the least of these, fighting for people who need him. People who are, Tim, I'll challenge your bacon and egg analogy when he talks about folks about this campaign race, that there are folks who are disappointed in what happened with the election this fall, and I'm not going to talk politics, but there are folks who are disappointed, but then there are folks who are afraid. And the job of those who are disappointed is to make sure we protect those who are afraid. And Tim is doing that every day in the United States Senate. So it is a special treat to be here with you tonight and reflect on the mission of the Moton Museum, and particularly on the leadership of Barbara Jones and her colleagues that spring day many years ago. And I think particularly of Barbara's courage and commitment, that what it took as a 15-year-old, and just to, here's a twist, and I'm sure you all know this story so much better than I that I won't presume to tell you, but here's my, one of the things that strikes me about this story is Barbara had quite a plan up to the moment that she led that walkout. She was quite a schemer, right? You all know the note to the principal and all of that. But she didn't have a whole heck of a lot of plan for what happened after that, right? We got everybody out. And then what's the outcome? What are the next steps? And, you know, the vision forward from that point, she was ready. She was clear. She had the courage to take that first step, not knowing what all the outcomes were going to be, not knowing what all those steps were going to be. But Barbara walked out that day, and you all know this too, she was more worried about the equal than the separate part of separate but equal. You know that, right? She led the walkout not thinking she was fighting to integrate schools, but rather thinking that the physical condition, the building they were in, she and her classmates, was totally inadequate to the circumstances. And the textbooks and the science labs and the facilities were inadequate. She was more focused on the unequal than the separate. And even within unequal, she was focused on facilities. The one thing you do not hear her complaining about was the teachers. I loved that Reverend Shannon mentioned in his remarks at the beginning of the evening that Ms. Vaughn, Barbara Vaughn, the teacher who taught at Moton throughout the 30s up to 1943, I think, when she went to NASA Langley to be one of those women mathematicians who helped get us into space. She taught at Moton High School along with other wonderful, wonderful leaders. The woman played by Octavia Spencer in the movie. One of the ironies, not knowing what the consequences of overturning separate but equal would be, one of the ironies is before Brown v. Board, so many great teachers had no option to teach anywhere other than in our African-American schools. When black people couldn't teach in the white schools, couldn't work at NASA Langley, couldn't work at jobs all over the economy, the schools, the black schools, were the leading place where these really wonderful educators could make contributions. Since then, we've watched how the employment sector has opened up to everybody. We've also watched the employment sector open up to women of all colors, but it's had an ironic twist that now some of those great teachers who Barbara and her colleagues had advanced to take advantage of now would have so many other opportunities, which we want them to have. But there's a certain irony there. There's a certain, sometimes we don't know, Barbara didn't know when she led that walkout that there would be a time when the Prince Edward schools would close for 5 years. She didn't know that it wouldn't be a steady march towards progress. She didn't know that we would have setbacks, that we would have deviations along the path. And yet she had the courage and the vision to say, no matter, we need to push forward. I am very honored to have shared my little moment in the sun of a couple of decades after Barbara's, and in a much, much more minor way. I had the pleasure, actually, a few years ago, Joy Steeks and I were trying to remember just how many years ago, but she and I were on a panel together in Richmond talking about integration of the schools and our personal experiences. Joy was friends with, she reminds me, one of Barbara's younger siblings, so she was much younger but Joy, who's with us here today, she spoke about the experience being in this community at that time. There was also a woman with us who spoke so poignantly, I could remember her words today, who was one of the first two girls, African-American girls, to integrate the Richmond City schools when the first two black children went to a formerly all-white school, Chandler Middle School, in the early 1960s. And it was a very painful experience, very, very difficult, like the experience here in Prince Edward when schools closed. There was harm and suffering and real courage and sacrifice. I followed those two women on that panel and felt very humble to share the podium as I do tonight. My chapter was in 1970. As Tim told you, my dad was inaugurated governor in January of 1970 and announced in his inaugural address that the era of defiance is over, that it was his top number one goal of his administration was going to be to help move Virginia forward towards racial reconciliation, which was a huge break with other Southern governors. But those were pretty words to start with in his inaugural address in January of 1970, and he did not know then that he would have an opportunity, as he likes to call them, opportunity time is his motto. He's 93 years old and doing well, he did not know when he made that inaugural address that just a very few months later, that following summer, a judge would issue an order ordering crosstown busing to end the de facto segregation that had continued in the Richmond City schools so long after the Brown versus Board of decision came along. And we were living in the governor's mansion at the time, we being my siblings, my parents and me. We lived downtown. We were kind of in a little carve out from the rest of the city because we were on state property, and so we really could have picked what school we wanted to go to. We weren't really directly governed by the court's order, but we made the family decision. You all, I bet some of you have had family meetings where family decisions were made, and we 12, 13, 14-year-olds, we thought we were actually voting and making, contributing to the decision, but lo and behold, the decision came out the way my parents hoped, that we decided that we would comply with the court's order, and all we did was comply with the court's order and go to the schools to which we would have been assigned had we not had the state property not been separate from the property right across the street. That meant that I went for 2 years, my seventh and eighth grade years, to what was then Mosby Middle School, named after a Confederate general, now renamed Martin Luther King Middle School, I'm happy to say. But we went for 2 years to Mosby Middle School in the Churchill neighborhood of Richmond. Now that was formerly an all African American school, and frankly continued to be an almost all African American school because, needless to say, many of the white people who were directed there, assigned there that year, did not manage to show up. And that was the era, you all know this, of schools in church basements, people fleeing to the county, finding every which way to not show up because this experience seemed so scary to so many people. And that's one of the saddest parts about it, is just to think, you know, what a lost opportunity. I, on the other hand, and my colleagues at school, white and black, the few other white students who showed up, and the majority black colleagues at Mosby, had a couple of really wonderful school years with great teachers and great education, and we had a drama department, and we put on plays, and we started a cheerleading squad, and did all the normal, ordinary things that seventh and eighth graders do, and had drama on stage and off, as 12 and 13-year-olds do. For me, it was an experience that marked me really for life. I had grown up in Roanoke. We had just moved to Richmond just shortly before this when Dad was inaugurated. And in Roanoke, my world was very homogenous, not only all white, but all really middle class, all upper middle class, all Protestant. You know, I didn't know folks from different religious backgrounds. I didn't know folks from, diversity was not in my experience. So it was a learning experience for me to be at Mosby. Not everybody was like me. We did have differences. But we learned from each other, from our differences, as well as from our similarities. And the truth was, the similarities prevailed, that we had so much more in common. The things we were worried about, the things we were excited about, were really the things that stand out in my memory. And I made great friends there, went on to open high school, and graduated from public schools in Northern Virginia when we moved. My siblings also had amazing experiences in the Richmond City Schools, and those years marked all of us. They marked us all because of what we learned, what we learned in the classroom and what we learned out of the classroom, but it also marked us because it was an opportunity. Not every 12-year-old has the opportunity to be of service to others. Not every 15-year-old has the opportunity that Barbara and her colleagues had to be part of something bigger than yourself. And it was with my parents' encouragement and help, we saw it that way. We saw it as an opportunity to be of service and an opportunity to do something that mattered. And what a great gift. What a great gift. Well, I won't talk, I could talk for a long, long time about my later engagements with education, and I won't, because we have more exciting things to do, and it's been a lovely, wonderful evening already. But I thought I would just wrap with just a few little observations from my time as Secretary of Education and now on the Board of Education. And I'm going to tell you, I started off with talking about we don't know about all the outcomes of what would come from what Barbara did. I'm going to go back to that theme. You know, there's some ironies. Things don't always turn out as we thought they did. When we helped integrate the Richmond City Schools, the truth is we didn't really integrate the Richmond City Schools as much as we integrated the county schools around us. All those folks fled to the county, but guess what? Now the county schools got black and brown and white, and folks from all over the world in their schools are fairly healthily integrated in many ways, and yet our urban cores are not particularly well integrated. Something that I feel very, very passionate about as Secretary is that we've got a long way to go still on bringing people together, on helping people have that experience we had of being in engagement, connected in engaging ways with folks from differing backgrounds and differing across everything, race, economics, experience. It's just so, so important. We also have a long way to go on Barbara's original goal of equity. We have a lot of schools that do not have the facilities that other schools have. We have urban high poverty schools. We have rural high poverty schools that don't have the facilities. We have schools that don't have the teachers. Ironically, again, we're almost now a step back from where some of the situation was when Barbara led the walkout. We've been asking our schools to do so much more with so much less for now a good couple of decades, and I've stepped into the education policy world at the point where our schools are really suffering from budget cuts that happened during the recession, from which we are really only beginning to creep out in depending on where you live. In Virginia, we did make a major new infusion of funds for schools that Governor McAuliffe got through the legislature and the General Assembly blessed over the last couple of years, but we've still got a long way to go. Our schools are really hurting for resources. They're hurting for resources across the board in all divisions, but especially in our high poverty communities. In the wealthier communities, the localities have picked up where the state has not stepped up. But in our higher poverty communities, we're really seeing shortages. We're asking our schools to do more with less in so many ways. We're giving them less resources. We're giving them young people with more challenges. The number of young people who are English language learners in our school system has gone way up over the last couple of decades. The number of children who are economically disadvantaged has gone from 30 to 40%. of the school system in Virginia over the last 15 years. Now 40% of our kids qualify for free or reduced lunch. All that we've done at the same time that we've been raising standards and asking our teachers to help our kids meet tougher and tougher accountability measures. And guess what? You ask people to do more with less for a long, long time, and it just puts incredible stress on our schools, and especially our high-poverty schools. So now we've got situations where our teachers, to stay in the schools where we need them the most, our very best teachers we want in our schools where kids really need that great education as a ticket out of poverty, the pressures on those teachers are just enormous. And we're seeing high-quality teachers fleeing, leaving the system, retiring early. We're seeing teacher shortages, and now we're in a mood where there's talk of vouchers and other things that are just not honoring the value of our public schools, and it's very troubling. So I don't want to end on a gloomy note, but I say this just to say that, and our schools are doing such great work every day. One of the great honors and pleasures as secretary is I did get to visit schools all across the Commonwealth, and even ones that were struggling with less than adequate facilities and with very, very difficult circumstances. There are teachers out there loving our kids and instilling in them a love of learning every single day, all across our country, all across our Commonwealth and all across our country. And yet, we have these intractable challenges, and it's sort of the more things change, the more they stay the same. I read a speech recently, reviewed Dr. King's speech that he gave at Syracuse University in 1965, talking about public education and him talking about the impact of ingrained poverty on our schools, and it felt like it was, you could have written it yesterday. But he ends that speech with a message that he talked a lot about time in a lot of different contexts. I know there are a lot of wonderful Dr. King quotes about the passage of time, but the one he ended there with was the time is always right to do what is right. The time is always right to do what is right. And so I invite you today to rededicate yourself to the great work you're doing here in supporting the Mogan Museum. It is so important that we think about our history, that we remember our history, that we remember the painful part of our history, but also remember the amazing leadership we see in our history so that they can inspire us moving forward. The time is always right to help support our schools, and I hope all of you, I know the Mogan Museum does such great work partnering with your local schools here and schools all across the Commonwealth. I invite you to continue that passion, and I invite all of you to continue to be great champions for public education everywhere you go and in everything you do. The time is always right to do what is right. Thank you for everything you do. Good evening.